Thanks, Cameron, and welcome everyone today. First, I'd like to thank the co-authors, Justin and Catherine, and also the North Central CMA and the MDBA for funding this project. As Cam just said, I'm talking about carp movements within the forest during a flooded, so it's all about last year's floods. So Charles has covered a bit of a background about the Gunbower Forest. As he said, it's recognised as an icon site with a vision of self-sustaining diverse wetland, native fish and macroinvertebrate communities. So where is the floodplain? Well, Gunbower, it's in the north central Victoria. It's an island with the Murray River bounding at one side and Gunbower Creek running through the other side. The important parts to note here are, as Charles said, you've got a hip well road regulator towards the top end of the forest, and that's used for inflow only, so managed flows or environmental flows, and that can be managed to stop fish getting off the floodplain. There is a fishway there if you want to operate it, but you have got a management option regarding that one. The other one is the lower landscape regulators that Charles mentioned, which were down this bottom part. The main ones I want to talk about will be shilling laws, and I'll highlight where that is later. But these lower landscape regulators have bi-directional flow, so you've got lateral movement of fish between. They can be managed to stop it. They're also an important component of getting that carbon transfer that Ian talked about yesterday back into the river system to help produce conductivity, and there's lateral fish movement from there. The other important part is the natural forest outfall at Chinaman's Bend, and it's right down the bottom end of the floodplain. It actually goes into Gunbower Creek. It's used for carbon export, but there's no management regulator or structure here at all, so it's got open fish movement either way without any option to stop the entry or exit of any fish from that system. So in essence, we can manage the natural floods through the regulators, but a natural flood, as Charles just said, we have got no control over. It just goes over the top of all those regulators. And for this system, with natural floods, about 14,000 meg a day, some of the lower lying effluent fields, some of the wetlands start filling, but it's really those 27,000 megalitre flows per day. This is based at Trumbury Weir Gauge, where you get the conductivity and the flow through the whole system. Operating strategy that's currently undertaken does have great biodiversity benefits for the water birds and the vegetation and the red gums. But we've noticed with monitoring done by other agencies and ourselves that there's strong recruitment of carp in response to the delivery of flows into the Gunbower Creek. And they're having impacts on the floodplain. An example, that's a carp exclusion cages. You've seen a few of these, they're pretty significant. You can see within the carp exclusion cage, you do get some aquatic veg and outside it's not. And someone mentioned the other day, that's also related to density dependence. So there's obviously lots of carp on this floodplain to have that impact. Because of all these carp on there, the CMA identified, so the North Central CMA identified that the Gunbower Forest needed a carp management strategy. And that was to help inform future flows delivery into the forest. But it's also so that it could document complementary management actions that can be used to reduce the numbers of carp locally and potential export to the broader environment, which Charles just talked about. Charles covered a bit about the carp life history regarding their fast growing, mature early, fairly fecund, million eggs, that sort of stuff. But what else do we need to know about them? For this area, we know that the recruitment is strongly influenced by flows and water management. We know they love to spawn on the floodplain vegetation. They spawn at 15 plus degrees in the spring, summer, and we know that they can migrate up more than 200 kilometres to get to these inundated floodplain vegetation wetlands. We know, as Matt said the other day, the floodplains are highly productive. They're shallow, they're warmer, they've got lots of growth. They're excellent rearing habitat for lots of fish, but unfortunately for carp as well. And they do really well in these sorts of environments. And it's been proposed that a number of of wetland floodplain systems are hotspots for carp recruitment. So where we're talking about today, the Kundrup Parakuta Gunbower Forest is one of these identified hotspots. I'm only talking about the Gunbower Forest side because that's where we targeted our movement of the fish. We track the fish. So how do you try and control their impacts? Well, at the moment, management relies on the understanding of the intrinsic behaviour, so the ecology of the carp, such as their spawning migration cues. And there's lots of examples of barriers and traps to exclude them getting onto wetlands. There's been a few examples already presented this week. But it's been identified that within the Gunbower Forest, there's still lots of knowledge gaps and to inform the carp management strategy. So some of these are the carp population model that was just talked about in the previous talk, and can we use some of the infrastructure such as the lowland regulators or other interventions to reduce the carp population within the Gunbower Forest but within the Murray-Darling Basin as a whole. And so they've done examples of depletion trials, and that's to work out the standing stock of carp that remain on the floodplain upon recession or disconnection, and that's to provide real data to that carp population model. And they've also undertaken a movement study, which is what I'm talking about today. So we used acoustic telemetry to track carp in the Gunbower Forest, and that was specifically to identify the entry-exit pathways. So where do they get on and off the floodplain? The pathways of floodplain movement, where do they go? When do they go? How do they go? And then once the floodplain has receded, the residual accumulations once the wetlands are disconnected and if there's any refuge habitat areas. This talk's only talking about the first two, the pathway movements, because it's only early on in the study. So how do we do it? So we used acoustic receivers. It's pretty simple. We implant a tag into the fish. That tag transmits a unique signal, which is picked up by an acoustic receiver that's under the water. That acoustic receiver detects that signal from the tag, and it adds a date and timestamp. So we know to the second that it swam past that receiver. In this sort of system in the Murray, you'll probably expect 300 or 400 metre range. Some of the ones in the forest would be reduced due to the vegetation and density of the vegetation. So it gives you an idea of how they work. So we put 15 acoustic receivers into the forest. We really targeted those lowland regulators and forest draining locations. So for some of those, we had a receiver on the forest side of the regulator, but also on the river or creek side of the regulator, and that was to really determine that, yes, they have moved through that location. And we knew when we started this work that there's opportunistic receivers. So Wayne presented some data today on the Goulburn. We knew there was receivers there. We knew there was receivers up and downstream in the Murray, and also at the Gunbower Creek Murray Junction. And we knew that New South Wales had some in the Kundrup Parakuta Forest. And I'll talk about those later because they actually add value to this project. So this is where I said, this is the location of the receivers. The main ones we want to highlight is where Chinaman's Bend was, right down the bottom, the natural forest outfall. Shillinglaw's regulator, so we've got, as I said, two receivers there. And then we've got some receivers in amongst some of the remaining wetlands, so Little Gunbower Creek, Reedy Lagoon, and then some of them are in very shallow floodplain areas. And so most of them were towards the lower end, and then we did have some moving right up to the top where the managed flows can come in. This particularly was a natural flood. There was no water going via the hip well channel. And there's just some examples showing that some of the receivers were in connecting channels between the floodplain and the river. Some are in shallow areas and some are in some of those larger remnant wetland locations. So we tagged 40 carp in September last year. They were captured by boat electrofishing. We did the standard stuff, measured their length, their weight, tagged them. So we acoustically tagged. We also put in pit tags in case they went through the Trumbury Weir Fishway. And we put in some externally T-bar tags in case some of the anglers caught some of the fish or we recaptured them ourselves to know that was a acoustically tagged fish. And where possible, we identified the sex. So we tagged 10 at Chinaman's Bend, so that's that natural outfall that I talked about. We tagged 14 within the remnant wetlands, although they were inundated by the time we put them in. and 16 at Shillinglaw's regulator, and that's the, one of the main entry exit locations for the Murray. So just briefly how we did it, you've probably all seen this before. We cut open the fish, insert the transmitter, stitch it up and let it go. So this is a hydrograph showing the size of the flood and the timing around what we did. I'll just show that in August there was a preceding flood that went into the Gunbower Forest. That flood hadn't actually reached Chinaman's Bend by the time we did our work. So we put the tags in around here on the 15th of September. And the other thing I want to note that during this period here, during the major height of the flood, the Trumbury weir gates were open. And that just means there was unimpeded fish passage during that time. So we downloaded receivers in early December, so it's really only a snapshot of just prior, during and immediately after the flood. We detected all 40 fish. They had a very dynamic and varied response. It's one of those R factors, how do you analyse this? Where have they gone? What have they done? They were everywhere, all directions, all times. And we got, oh gee, so it's behaviour totally random, order chaos, what was it? So it was really complex. As I said, one of the fish went in at least 20 kilometres into the Kunduk Parakuta Forest and came back out. Some of them went into the river and merged long distances. Some went into the river, stayed in the same area. And lights went, you know, just within the forest itself and didn't exit. So 35 exited the forest. But at the end, when the flood receded, there was 10 back on the floodplain. So some went off the forest, came back and stayed there. Some stayed on there the whole time. It was very, very varied, if that makes sense. So in general, they all responded to the floodplain inundation. There's no clear pattern within the floodplain. But we did notice a little bit in the tagging location differences. So the fish that were tagged right down the bottom at the natural outfall didn't move through the forest as much as the ones that were tagged elsewhere. And that's important. If you only tagged from that area, you would have got a totally different response, and it could affect source population sizes and lots of other components. And a number of fish showed site fidelity. So they returned to their tagging location after the flood receded, and some of that was on the floodplain or back to the Murray River at that location at those exit entry points. So regarding the entry movements, we identified three or possibly more. So Chinaman's, that natural outfall, as expected. Shillinglaw's regulator, as expected. And there was another one, we're pretty sure it's Burr Creek, but we need further investigation to determine this. And it only fills when the floods get to 27,000 meg. And there may be more on the upstream side, but we should find out if we get another flood and have receiver at Spur Creek. They exited throughout and re-entered throughout the whole period, although there was a couple of, I'll call them groupings. So it's around the peak of the flood in mid-October and late in the floodplain draining. Someone thought, let's get out of here, let's not get stranded. So some exited the floodplain and re-entered the floodplain. Some of those used the same location, some used multiple locations. So some used Chinamans and Shillinglaws, some used Shillinglaws and the unknown location, and they're all mixed up. So. But interestingly, we had some dynamic river movement as well. So some stayed around the Gunbower. We had two large distance river movements that I want to highlight. So four of the fish went down to the Little Murray River. That's approximately 110 kilometres downstream. They left in mid-September, so not long after tagging, prior to their spawning. They were detected at the Little Murray River 48 to 58 hours after they left. They were down there for about 9 weeks. Then they came back up, and about 4 or 5 days after being detected at Little Murray River, they were re-detected again at the Gunbower Creek Murray River junction. And that was after the floodplain receded, and I'm assuming post-spawning. So they left at the carp known hotspot and bred out elsewhere. And the other one is there's four fish went up to Broken Creek, and I'll show you an example of these. So they were tagged mid-September, stayed on the floodplain for about a month. Then they moved up through the forest, exited the forest, went straight through Trumbury Weir when the gates were open, and kept on going up past the Campaspe and up to the Goulburn River. And this is still around that peak of the flood mound, mid-October. They stayed around there for about a week. Then they moved up, and a month later they were detected at Barmer, so the Broken Creek Junction, another known hotspot. However, they only stayed there for a day or two, and then they quickly zoomed back down to the Campaspe. So that's about 70 kilometres from the Broken to Campaspe. Some did that in less than a day, some took up to 3 days. So that was the same pattern for all four fish that did that, or that showed that response. Just a week after Turumbury Weir was it was partially closed, so it's not fully open anymore, another few fish hit there and didn't pass through. So I think we can investigate the management of Turumbury Weir, because there could be something there. So in summary, as I said, the movement was very dynamic. A large number undertook migrations, dispersals. There's limited entry exit points for management implications. They showed site fidelity. And there's an increased dispersal during the carp breeding period. There's greater population mixing, there's greater resources available, and they use it all. What's this mean for management? Well, during natural floods, there's overbank flows, the structures are drowned out, there's not a lot we can do. And those large floods may be taking away the focus from those identified hotspots, because they can breed anywhere, but they still might be important within those floods, but also more important during the drier times. And it's sort of, some of this is backing up Charles's model. He's just showed us that stop card exiting from Chinaman's Bend. Maybe we need to do some sort of management structure at that location for carp. And you know, this study can help inform the landscape spread model for the virus, or the release model for the virus regarding the timing, stuff like that. And thank a few people.